Module 7 looks at two kinds of hypothesis tests, one sample mean and one sample proportions. To illustrate each of these, consider the registered voters in the United States. One variable we might want to consider with those voters is gender. That's an example of a categorical variable. Another variable of interest might be how tall the individuals are. That's an example of a numerical variable. A parameter associated with that categorical variable would be what proportion of the population is female. A parameter associated with height might be what is the average height of the population. A hypothesis test comes into play when somebody makes a claim about that population parameter. For example, someone might claim that the proportion of females in the population is more than 65%. That's called the alternative hypothesis or the research hypothesis. In the case of the average height parameter, somebody might claim that the average height is less than 5 feet 10 inches. The challenge in this module is determining which kind of problem you have, and secondly, how to carry out the hypothesis test in that problem. So let's look at each of these individually in some detail. In the first case, we were looking at registered voters in the United States. The variable we were considering was gender. The population parameter was the proportion of women in the population. A researcher made the claim that this proportion of women in the population was greater than 65%. Now, if someone disagreed with that claim, they would be saying that the proportion was less than or equal to 65%. That hypothesis that has the equal sign in it is called the null hypothesis, and usually we just say equals to. We'll try to determine which of these hypotheses is correct by taking a sample of some particular size. N will be the sample size. In a hypothesis test, we begin by assuming the null hypothesis is true. We take a sample of size n and find the proportion in that sample. If we assume the null hypothesis is true, then we know the probability of success. And we're looking at n Bernoulli trials, and this is just a binomial distribution. So we're sampling from a binomial distribution, and we can then calculate the proportion of successes that we got in our sample. So let P hat be the proportion of females, the proportion of successes that we had in our sample. Now, because this came from a binomial distribution, this distribution of proportions could be approximated by a normal distribution, where the mean of all the sample proportions, the mean of all the P hats, is equal to P, the parameter that we're trying to make some decisions about. The standard deviation of this distribution of sample proportions is given by the square root of P times Q divided by N, where Q is the probability of failure. In other words, Q is 1 minus P. Just to keep track of things, we'll generally call this standard deviation of sample statistics the standard error, SE. Now, we could convert all the values here in this normal distribution to their z-scores. That means this p hat that we got from our sample could be converted to a test statistic z. Because we're doing an upper-tailed test, we know that because of the alternative hypothesis, we want to find this area. In other words, the probability of getting a z or something more in accordance with the alternative hypothesis, z or bigger. Now, remember, we were assuming that the null hypothesis was true. If this area, that probability, is small, then we will reject the null hypothesis. What it means for that probability to be small, or in other words, for this to be an unusual event, is determined by an alpha value. That alpha value is something that somebody determines. If nobody has said what the alpha value is, then we will say that it's 5%. So if the alpha value is low, the null hypothesis must go. What that means is that if it's unusual for this to happen, if this probability, that area, is less than 5%, then we will reject the null hypothesis, and therefore there is evidence supporting, statistical evidence supporting, that the alternative hypothesis is true. Otherwise, if that area is not less than alpha, then we'll fail to reject the null hypothesis, and we don't have sufficient evidence to support the alternative hypothesis. The second problem that we looked at also looked at the collection of registered voters in the United States. In that case, the variable was how tall each person was. The population parameter was that the mean height of the population was going to be equal to mu. Some researcher had the belief that mu was less than 70 inches. That means that the null hypothesis is that mu is equal to or greater than 70 inches. We'll take a sample of size n to look for evidence of which one of these hypotheses is correct. So in this case, we're taking a sample of size n from the variable x, which is measuring the height of each of the people in the population. Now, it's reasonable to assume that that distribution of heights is normally distributed. It's the mean of that distribution that we want to find something out about. As is always the case in hypothesis testing, we're going to assume the null hypothesis is true. We'll take our sample of size n and calculate the mean of that sample. That will be our point estimate. The central limit theorem tells us that if we looked at every sample of size n and calculated the mean of each one of those, then the distribution of all of those sample means would be normally distributed. Furthermore, the mean of all of those sample means will be equal to the mean of the original population, which is the parameter we're trying to understand. It's also known that the standard deviation of all those sample means will be equal to the standard deviation of this original population divided by the square root of n, which is the sample size. Now, that's an interesting theoretical fact, but our problem is that we don't know what this standard deviation of this original population is. So we do the best that we can. From the sample that we took, we can find the sample standard deviation and use that as an approximation for this population standard deviation. So we'll use this and we'll call this a standard error again. Now we want to translate this information to a standardized distribution. The problem is that we can't convert this to a z-score because we're using an approximate here. So what we'll do is convert this to a t-score, a t-distribution. That x-bar will convert to a test statistic, which we will call t. We're using a t-distribution, so we need to know the degree of freedom. In this case, the degree of freedom is going to be n minus 1. Because we're doing a lower tail test, we know that because of what the alternative hypothesis is. It's less than. So we're doing a lower tail test. We want to find the area below that test statistic and see how it compares to the alpha value. If somebody's told us what the alpha value is, fine. If not, we'll say that it's 5%. And if that area is less than 5%, then it's saying that this would be a very unusual situation to occur, assuming that the null hypothesis is true. So we would reject the null hypothesis, and therefore this is providing evidence that the alternative hypothesis is true. On the other hand, if that area is greater than alpha, then we fail to reject the null hypothesis, and at this point we don't have sufficient evidence to support the alternative hypothesis.